Good morning. I'm Cindy Williams with Get a Real Estate Life and eXp Realty, and welcome to our Thursday morning interview. Gusty Gulas and I, every Thursday morning, we are out seeking talent and interviewing them so that we can bring to you new ways to do business. And so welcome, Gusty.
Hey, good to see you this morning.
And y'all, Gusty is going to be answering and monitoring those questions. So we want you to ask anything of our guest, Angelo or Gusty or me. We're just here to have a good time, help, and talk about some high volume real estate. So
I want
to welcome our special guest, Angelo. Welcome.
How's it going, guys? Good to see you. Oh, good to see you again, actually.
No, so glad that you are here and joining us from Orange Beach today.
Hi. Pleasure's all mine. I'm so honored.
So, Angelo, tell us a little bit about, you know, where you are, you know, what your background story is, how long you've been in real estate.
So, I'm in Orange Beach, Alabama, like you said. I'm wrapping up my sixth year in real estate, and I've always been in some form of sales. And 6 years ago, me and my wife wanted to move down to the beach. We're spending most of our weekends here. So I left, turned in my notice. It was kind of cool. Like the guy I was working for, it's like, perfect. I'm looking to sell my condo. Was like my first deal. It was this big giant deal. And it was interesting that first year, like you're kind of figuring out where, you know, where to go. I didn't really have, like, I wouldn't call any mentorship or anything. And then 2 years into it, I had an opportunity to buy into half of the Caldwell Banker brokerage that I was working for. So I did that, and I became the qualifying broker, which I had no business doing at the time. But, you know, it's like the American dream. You want to own your own business. You think you're going to build this big, giant organization. And, man, that first year was tough. I didn't sell as much real estate. And I spent most of that year really kind of going to conferences and trying to figure out how to make it profitable, because when I bought into it, it was losing money every year. And I thought, you know what, like we all do, we all have this ego. We think we can turn something around. And so I bought into that. And the next year we actually did turn a profit. Granted, when you own 50% of something and you're running it, when you have to give half those profits to your partner, and rightfully so, that I looked at it and I was like, you know, I could just go sell two more real estate deals and make the same amount of money and not have to run a squirrel farm. I mean, it's really hard to come up every week with that weekly sales meeting, bring a ton of value. And then since it was a Caldwell Banker, the way our commission splits were set up and what we had to give back to corporate, I couldn't really bring over the best agents to our company. And like, what was going to be the exit strategy in 20 years when I was done? Like, what did I have left? Like, I couldn't imagine if you did a multiple of 5 on that company, I couldn't have retired on it. So a friend of mine from Nashville who was in the same coaching program I was in called me up and said, hey, I want to come down and show you this new real estate deal. And I said, well, look, buddy, got 5 years left on a 10-year agreement. Like, you can come on down, but it's a waste of your time. But, you know, it was like a courtesy deal. And when I saw it, I thought, how are we going to get out of our agreement with Caldwell Banker? And it took about a year to work through the legalese of that. It's been the best decision I've made. Like, since doing that, we've more than doubled our real estate sales. I make more money off of the people that I've brought into the eXp organization than I did off my agents without the constant outlay of cash. Because if you're looking to recruit agents, you're like, what do you offer if your splits aren't really good? You're really offering like, hey, I can offer you a lot of leads. So we're doing a lot of SEO. So, yeah, that's kind of how I ended up where I am now.
Well, what did you do before real estate?
Oh, so, you know, it's funny. Life takes you in different directions. I tried mortgages right out of college, and I'm a high in the DIS test performance. I'm a high I, high D, but I'm not a good systems person. And mortgages, you better be a good systems person to get those the program. So I didn't do really – I was good at getting business. I wasn't good at bringing it to the closing table. So if you're not good at doing that at mortgages, you're not going to go anywhere with it. Then I sold radio advertising. And all you had to do in radio advertising was go sell. And I was really good at it. So it kind of got my mojo back. In between that and radio advertising, I actually worked on fishing boats, which was fun. When you're in your 20s, you don't have any responsibility. Great time. Then I went from radio to an ad agency, and I was doing a lot of boat dealerships. So I saw how much it was like right in 2007 when everybody, like 2006, 2007, when the economy was pumping. I was looking at like these boat guys, they were making a killing. So I went and go do sell boats in the beginning of 2008. I made the least money I ever made in my life. Like timing was just horrible for that. But through that, and I always feel like this, like when one door closes, another one opens. I met this guy named Gene Torrance. He owned a equipment rental company. And we've developed a relationship through the course of buying a couple of boats. And he was like, you ought to go do equipment rentals, which another really good fit for me, because here again, it was really just sales. And there was somebody else handled all the real heavy lifting work in the background and relationships. And like, that's all real estate is relationships.
That's right.
But my heart had always been here to be at the beach. I grew up on the coast, and most of my time was spent on job sites. And so me and my wife said, if we ever moved here, one of us had to get a job down here. And I remember even in college, I wanted to do real estate, but you know, real estate's one of those professions that it can leave a bad taste in your mouth if you see other people do it. Or you've dealt with realtors. You're like, I'm not sure if I want to be associated with this group of people. But my friend who's a mortgage broker, he's like, Angelo, you do great at it. And kind of gave me the confidence to kind of take that leap of faith. And I tell people all the time, it's been the best decision I've ever made in my life. I don't think I could ever go back and do anything else.
Well, you know, what's funny is everybody does think that becoming a broker is like a huge honor. And as we've arrived, we have gotten to that broker spot. And Gusty always says, it's the most overrated, even Tracy Lewis said that, hyped up, worst job you could ever have on the planet. There's just so much pressure to it, so much expense to it, so much on your shoulders to take on that responsibility, especially when you're really good at sales, because if that is your forte and you arrive to being a broker, it can really put you in a miserable situation. So what's also interesting is you have several things in common with Gusty's background.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I mean, I was in the mortgage business for a little while. and so I did that for a couple of years, and I think that was one of the good ways that I was able to learn how to generate leads and learn how to do great follow-up plans on those leads, because you know, we were really focused. Like, we had to dial 150 people a day or get 100 or get 5 applications. Well, I didn't want to talk to 150 people a day. I wanted to have like 5 good quality conversations to get those applications. And so, but it gave me a great work ethic for leading up into to real estate sales. And I definitely found it a lot easier to find people to look to buy or sell a home than to use me for financing. And so, And then my major was actually radio management. So I spent a little time with radio advertising, but I definitely was not good at that. So,
you made the transition. You know, my dad used to own a boat dealership, and I grew up on the coast as well. So, I understand some of those aspects of it too, because dad's been a real estate broker my entire life. And, you know, he retired for a while and bought a fish camp and owned a boat dealership. So it's funny that, you know, so many stories here circle around each other. Like some people say, there are only a few stories that ever repeat themselves over and over, but we're so glad that you found yourself in real estate. And, you know, what's it like to sell? Your market's totally different than ours in Birmingham. What's it like to sell vacation properties or retirement properties?
You know, I think the biggest difference, and I've never sold like a true residential market. I probably do one of those transactions every year for somebody that's going to be their primary residence. One of the things I most enjoy about it, because you're dealing with a majority of high net worth people, is that you just meet the most interesting people, hedge fund guys, car dealers, just power brokers, just big attorneys. And it's uplifting to kind of be involved with those kind of people and kind of see how they work. And they're buying something that they've worked for their whole life. So it's a little blend of, and most of my stuff is true second homes. I deal with a handful of investment, but most of my people, just kind of the niche I fell into, has been second homes. Is like, hey, you're selling a bit of a lifestyle, but you've got to mix that in with the reality of like what you feel comfortable spending and how you're really going to use it versus like what it costs now, because it's a big upfront expense for people. And sometimes you're like, are you overpaying? Are you underpaying? Everybody's somewhat trying to manage, like figure out where the market is when they're buying. But I always tell my people that like my job is to get you to the finish line. I want to get you a good deal. I want to get you a fair deal. But with internet being what it is, nobody's getting a killer deal, or you don't realize it up front. You know, you usually realize it down the road if you see appreciation. But at the end of the day, does it really matter? Like, if your goal is to create memories and spend time with your friends and family, and you're going to own this place, or you're going to have a place down here at the beach for the next 20 years, like, the market's going to go up, the market's going to go down. If you're going to sell up, or move up to your property, you're going to just take the equity that you have now and put it in the other one. If it goes down, and you're going to go down to a different property, like, guess what? You're buying cheaper. Yeah, you took something on the front end. So, and I think that's kind of the perspective. The buyers are so much more sophisticated. Like, every once in a while, I get somebody that's buying a $200,000 primary residence, and like, they are hanging on your every word. They totally buy into what you're doing here. These people have bought multiple homes. They're very sophisticated. They're smart with their money. So you're really providing information to them and then backing it up with, hey, this is my opinion. And you got to really figure out what their overall picture is. It's not just like, what do we do for this one project, but what are we looking at over the next 5, 10, 20 years? What's your goal here? And I guess that's in real estate in general. I mean, we're dealing with a guy right now. He wants to buy a handful of investment properties, but like, he's got a lot of cash, but at the same time, he wants to finance, but you can't use, you know, the future earnings on your investments to build your debt to income ratios. So, you know, it's strategy, and you got to really look, and that's kind of what it is. You're trying to get a whole picture of what somebody's doing, especially, I think, on second homes and investments.
So are most of your properties cash, or are they mostly financed?
You know what? The higher you go up in price, the more likely you're going to be cash. I would say at least 50% are cash, and it could be up to about a 70% cash from this year, probably.
What's your greatest lead source? Like, where do you find people who are interested in buying second homes and spending a lot of money on second homes?
I love this question, because when we had Caldwell Banker, we spent anywhere from $2,000 to $10,000 a month on SEO, driving leads to our website. And like, you know, if you go talk to companies that do that, that's going to sell you that product, they're going to tell you that you're going to close 3% of them. Like, I never closed more than 1% of them. And like, if you're on a splitting that with your agents, it's barely a cash maker. So I'm a big believer in, at the end of the day, real estate is getting belly to belly with people. It's relationships. And the only way you can really build those relationships is to really reach out and deliberately build those. So what we do is we have our top 50 sphere of influence, and we're constantly high grading that out. So those people, that's a monthly phone call. And we break that out 12-13 every Monday. We call those people, whether they answer or not, just to let them know we're here. And those are usually short phone calls, because what we're really doing is setting up lunch appointments, coffee appointments, because like, that's really where you get to know somebody. And we let them know that, hey, like, this is our business model, is to have relationships, and I want to be the connector for you. I feel like I do that better than most everybody else, and I have a ton of relationships. And so there may not be an opportunity for you to do business with me directly and vice versa, but there's probably somebody in my sphere that I can recommend to somebody in your sphere. And if we can kind of be that connector, it's like, let's bring all our torches together and make one big fire kind of thing. I think I hear Jay Kinder say that, and it like really resonates with me. And the other thing is, we're talking about people buying, and I think this is across all market segments, but people buying $500,000, $2 million second homes, like, guess what? All their friends are usually in that same socioeconomic category as well. Right. And they want to, their friends to come hang out with them at the beach. So like, the same way we treat our top 50, we do that with our top 50 past clients. We have them fill out all about you form, so we know their birthdays, their anniversaries, and we gift a lot. Like, that's our major strategy, is we do a birthday in a box. It's a little hostess cupcake, a candle, some matches, a little balloon, a little blower, and an instruction manual on how to wish yourself a happy birthday. It's just a small personal touch that I don't think a lot of people do. And we just kind of random gifts throughout the year. So it's always nice when you start getting the text messages, hey man, thanks for the Burt's Bees. That's just what we do right before Thanksgiving, because it's getting chilly and your lips are getting chapped. So that's our strategy, is to be a connector. And also the other great thing is relationships. I mean, connector, relationships, and now you have social media, which allows you to kind of do that on a bigger level. Maybe that lake isn't as deep, but it's much broader. So I love to go meet with local business owners, interview them on Facebook. This is my way of building my sphere. Hey, will you fill out all about me with, so I can keep up with you? It's the way we do it. And then you become a resource for people coming down here. Hey, Angelo, what's a good charter boat? What's a great restaurant? Like, they know that.
I've even done that to you.
Yeah. If they know that's your deal, like, you got to find your tribe. And like, for me, I love fishing. I love great food. I love hanging out, you know, I call it the 4S: fishing, family, food, and friends. Like, that all equals a good, fun time. Like, that's what I'm about. And those are the people that I know I'm going to click well with. Those are the people I want to work with.
All right. Well, I've got a question. All right. So this birthday in a box. So is this something that y'all put together, or is it something that you have found somewhere? So tell me about that.
We put it together. It costs, between shipping and everything, it's about $10 to do. And we build out a calendar every year: birthdays, anniversaries, National Doggy Day, National Cat Day. And then just kind of, we're a big believer in random gifts. So we, like I said, we do a Burt's Bees. We do, my wife just, hey, it's just a hostess cupcake. But like, we all the time get, you know, text messages, and we're trying to leverage that more into our social media to get them to tag us in that, so we can connect with their friends and let them know that, that this is how we want to operate. We want to be in a deep, meaningful relationship with you. And we want to be your resource and your friend's resources when it comes to buying. And what we do is, the week before that that their birthday's coming, we have an assistant. And there's no way one person can execute this all by yourself. And so you got to leverage, once you can do enough deals where you can leverage your time a little bit better, then our assistant, she, every week, the week before, everybody that's has their birthday scheduled, boom, we build out that box. She ships it out to them. They get a phone call from me. I just want to let you know, happy birthday. And it's a quick, easy touch. And it's something that.
So special, though. I love the birthday.
That's great. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, what CRM do you use?
I'm so embarrassed. Uh-oh. So we don't even have a website. We've been gone 18 months without a website. Like our CRM, I'll tell you, here's my greatness tracker right here. Like all the phone calls, we've got it leveled out. And here's my lead tracker for the month right here. We are literally in the process of building out a website.
That is high tech.
We're just going to attach KV Core to it. Like I wanted our website to not be a strictly real estate website. I feel like when you look at the industry and everybody else is doing one thing, I want to do something a little different. So our website's really going to be more of a resource of what's going on here in Gulf Shores and Orange Beach and Perdido Key. And like we'll beta test it here. And if we like it, we'll spread that out to other coastal communities and other communities in our county because we think we can produce a lot of leads. I think it's going to be easier to drive traffic to that website and then people can secondarily view real estate through it. And I'm just going to let the real estate side be an open page where you don't have to sign up for it. I just don't have the bandwidth to handle those leads. And I don't have a buyer's agent right now that I could push those off.
Yeah.
So we think that if we just keep it open, we can bring quality people in. They're ready to buy. Find enough value in what we do. They'll reach out. Maybe that's a good strategy. Maybe not.
I think you got to do what works for you. You know, it's like I have my to-do list is all written down. And so I have a method to my madness for that. And so I don't have a Rolodex on my desk. And so I don't know if you do or not, but hey, I like that you have your list and whatever works for you. I mean, that's the best CRM that's out there, whatever works for you. And as long as you're doing it, that's all that matters.
Yeah. So lucky, you know, here's my day. Every day I get one of these. I don't have to think about what I'm going to do. I've got my calls blocked out. I've got my lunches blocked out. I have this meeting with you guys blocked out. And it's nice to like, not be able to think about that because I'm not before I just show up. I didn't have any game plan and it worked out all right. But when somebody else puts it all together, I always tell people I'm like a hammer. I just do whatever my wife and my assistant tell me to do. And life is so much easier.
I know that's right.
We know April is super smart. So she's going to keep you in line.
Yeah.
Yeah. So one of the things that I have teached and preached for the past 10 years is something that you do beautifully, and that is going to small businesses and interviewing them on video. And I love watching your videos. They're fantastic.
Thank you. So I just think that is such an easy strategy to execute. It doesn't cost you any money. Other than a little bit of gas. I mean, I do everything live because I don't have the time to edit. I don't want to spend the money to have somebody else edit. I usually don't even watch them. Like, you just go do it, and if you know, sometimes it's good to watch so you can kind of critique yourself. Usually my wife watches and gives me the critiques for free. but the hardest part of that is this. The scheduling is going over there and talking to and then following up and scheduling that appointment. But like, that's a once a week deal. That's what it should be. And then that's how you become a mayor of your town. I was watching Nolly Williams actually give a class on it. I was like, oh, it's exactly what we're doing. And when you do that consistently, you build up relationships in your community. And like, that's a two, that's like, twofold deal for you. A, you're providing great content for people through your social media. And what we do is we ask them to give us a $25 gift card and we boost that post by $25. Like $25 on a boosted post goes a long way to reaching your target and their target. And you're really bringing a lot of value to them. And it really makes it easier to ask for that all about you form afterwards. So that we can really build a relationship with that person. The other thing is now you're building a relationship with a business owner, but you're also giving a lot of value, to people on your social media page, and you're building that following up as well. I mean, it's like a three-pronged deal there. That's I love it. It's easy, it's fun, and you kind of become a little celebrity in your community.
Well, you are supporting local businesses and giving to them by endorsing them and promoting them to your audience. But you also, by doing that, get into their audience. So their audience knows who you are and you have fresh people that you are being exposed to at all times. But it's just such a giving thing to do. And you end up also being the go-to person. So it's really, to me, the best win-win that you could do on your schedule every single week for a real estate agent. So I think it's awesome.
Let me tell you a little story about that. Because when I started doing that, like there's an agent down here pushing Red X real hard, go call property owners, build relationships that way. And I think that works too. I just hate cold calling. I'm just don't like it. It's no fun to me. And so I started doing it and my wife was like, you are driving all over town. This is a dumb idea. And I was like, no, I think it's going to work. Well, one day I pull in the parking lot and this guy pulls in right next to me and is like, hey, you're Angelo. I was like, damn right I am. One of those days where, you know, you're feeling pretty cocky. And he was like, man, my father-in-law is looking for a house. And he scribbled down the guy's name and number on the back of a receipt. And I just called it on the way up to my office. Well, the guy ends up being this big hedge fund guy out of Atlanta. Flies down the next week. He ends up double siding $1.4 million. I make probably the biggest commission I'd ever made. I was like, holy cow. I hadn't hardly done that much. It's like 3 weeks into it. Total luck job on it. But what happens is you're building that relationship with so many people that you don't know who's watching right. that all the time. And like I all the time, I figure I'm going to get 4 or 5 referrals a year, good, hot referrals that I'll close every year off of. And I'm like, you know what? That's the ROI on it, because we spend about $500 a month on just randomly boosting stuff that doesn't necessarily always have to do with us selling property.
Right.
And I just, you know, $6,000 a year, we'll make $100,000 a year off of referrals that come through it. It's easy. It's fun. And like, I think like the compounding effect 10 years down the road, I'd be very interested to see what that
means. Now, so what page do people need to look at that you're talking about?
So mine is the Coastal Connection. You know, it's funny whenever you talk to somebody, if you like, cause as we're going through the website build process, we spoke to a ton of ad agencies. You talk to all these real estate people, they all say, hey, you got to use your name in your Facebook page. And Genny, I don't think you do. And like, because you can build that brand to whatever you want it to be. And honestly, my name is hard to pronounce. And like, I just didn't want to be the person that people are stumbling over trying to figure out how to pronounce my name. So it's funny. I go out to restaurants, bars, or wherever I'm at. All the time, people are like, hey, Coastal Connection. So when you do it repetitively, and the key is like consistency on this, you can't do it 1 month and not do it for 3 more months and pick it up, because nobody's going to know who you are. You're not consistent enough. When you do it consistent enough, you will build a brand in your little community. And I'm in a community where most of the people that we deal with are out of town. And it works in a place that most of our buyers and sellers aren't even in town. But I know they're going to be in town periodically. they're going to, if they like my page, they're probably going to see our post.
It's one of my favorite things, and I love that about you. And you notice that I never say your last name so that I won't ruin it.
So, how do you pronounce it, Angelo?
Do what?
How do you pronounce your last name?
DePaola. So DePaola. The way I used to tell people is when I was in radio, there was a term called payola.
Yeah.
And so I was like, think payola, because I'm in radio. And just put a D in front of it and just say D, and that's how you pronounce it. But I get DePaola, D'Angelo. D'Angelo is the most...
I like that one.
...is the most common pronouncing of my name. It's the combination of two. I don't even correct people. Like, if I do, they still say it. I have a client right now that he knows exactly who I am, and he still calls me D'Angelo.
Do you sing a song when he says that? That's an artist, D'Angelo.
I did a little moonwalk.
There you go. I like it. That's funny.
What did you end up closing this year? Like, so far year to date, like, what's your volume? What have you ended up doing in your business?
So we're at 14,321,500. And I think when we wrap up everything, we'll be at 17,271,300. Just nice. Dab on the books and what we'll end up.
Living in paradise.
Yeah, that's fun. It's it wasn't where we wanted to end up at the year, but you know, we just went through some changes. As we're still, for us, we're still kind of understanding eXp and putting all those pieces back in place for us, with my wife coming in new, it was that first 6 months of us working together was like trying to figure out where everybody fit in. And I'll tell you the biggest, if I could give a recommendation, because I know there's a lot of people, that husband and wife teams that work with each other, one of them got in it, then they've done pretty well. And so the other one ends up coming in with them and helping, or not helping, really working with them, is go get a disc test done for both of you. And we use this guy named Manish. If anybody ever wanted to get it, they could reach out to you. I'd give you that number. That's $150 I've spent. It, like, really, we were able to understand where our strong suits were and where our weaknesses were. And it helped put us in our lanes. And April, she's like a blessing and a curse. Like, she goes, when she gets in a work environment, she goes from an DI, which is a boss and salesperson, almost to the middle of the disc where she can perform everything very well, which, like, I always thought that, but I didn't understand that about her. And so for her, she can do everything, but sometimes she gets into overanalyzation mode and it takes her longer to start implementing. For me, I'm a high ID, and when I get into work mode, I go way more I. And so, like, I'm trying, when we're getting disagreements in the beginning, I'm trying to sell her on my idea of why we should do something, but she being still leaning more D, just battled me on it. Well, like, we realized that she's better at systems. She's better at the whole operation side. And they just took me out of all that. Like, it's great. I don't even answer my emails mostly. It's her, Lee, that do all the emails. And so, like, at the end of the day, if you're looking to grow leads, like, our job as real estate agents is to procure leads. That's how we make money. If you can take all that other stuff off of your plate and just focus in on those, that you will make lots of money. And I don't know, people tell me they get into real estate because they want to help people and all that. And I get it. Hey, I like helping people too. But, like, if you're really honest, you got into real estate because it's an opportunity to make a really good living. And the opportunity is definitely there. But it's not easy. And I think you got to understand what kind of person you are to, and leverage your strengths I mean, I was having a conversation this morning with my trainer. Her husband went and got a real estate license. She decided that she wants to go get her real estate license. She's the salesperson. He's like, he ain't selling anything. I was like, you're the salesperson. He's operations. Like, you're like me. You'll go blow all your money on whatever. I'll do the same thing. That's just who I am. So I don't even know where we're going on this. I'm just rambling.
No, that's true. Jay is actually in the middle of getting his license right now, and he's a home builder. So he is pure operations, and I'm DI and he's CD. So, I mean, every single discussion has always been, and we've been married almost 30 years, this, everything. So I totally understand, but April is so polished and she's such a support, and you know, she's just got her stuff together, and you know it anytime that you talk with her. She's just such a fantastic addition to your business.
He says, thank you. And I'm lucky. I totally outkicked my coverage on every aspect. I mean, like when we go, we're on an appointment together yesterday. I'm like, she's better than I am at this. And like, she could do this. I couldn't do this without her. She could do this without me.
Well,
she'll argue that.
She's watched you do it. Just like Gentry, my daughter went on a listing appointment with me yesterday. And it was a very typical listing appointment. You hear all the history of the house, the marriages, the divorce, the refinance, what happened in each room. And Gentry didn't say one word the entire time. We came back and mentioned, you know, what the experience to Jay, and Jay gave us the entire scenario without being there. And because once you watch it, know it, and you can turn it into a system, and that's how April thinks. So I personally love that. So what are your goals for next year?
So I think every year we try to increase what we do 20%. Like, that is a very reasonable goal to reach every year. And then not just, so that's like the financial side of it, but then you have this whole other side of like really, I say creating your business, right? Like, you've got stuff you want to implement. And I think one of the biggest mistakes I've made in the past, I think that just mistakes, not just real estate agents, but business owners in general. And I think that's just, if you're a real estate agent, that's how you've got to look at it. You're not working for somebody else. You're a business owner. So you got to be on a platform that allows you to operate at peak efficiencies. So we would go off to either coaching conferences, or we'd go to an event, and you'd get all these ideas, and you'd have 10, 25 things, and you come back, you're like pumped up, you're like, all right, you're just ready to run through a wall, and 3 weeks later you're back doing the exact same things you were doing prior to. And that's because, like, what we always did was we try to implement 20 things in 1 month and you don't do anything. So we've gotten to the point where, and there's a great book about this called Traction, and they call these little bits rocks, and you assign those to people. And so if it's just yourself, one a quarter, implement one thing a quarter into your business. And in the year, that's 4 new things that you've brought into your business. It's 2 of you, that's 8 new things. 3 of you, that's 12 new things that you can add to your business. And then over the course of a handful of years, your business is totally different than what it was when you started to where you're at. And not all of them are going to work. So you can kind of, you'll figure that out as you go. But the key is implementation of new things. So we're going to have our website up online first quarter of this year. We've never done a monthly like email, like market update of where we, you know, what's going on, not just in our market, but like restaurants and stuff. We've kind of done that through social, but we've never done that. I think like there's an opportunity for us to connect with more people, because sometimes you get the low hanging fruit, But like the people that are maybe 12 months out, you lose sometimes. And then bringing KV Core in and dropping those people into that and being able to drip on them and keep us hopefully front of mind if they are serious buyers, do that. That's our first three things. And then we'll go out of first quarter and we'll reevaluate where we're at. And we'll try to add three more things into second quarter. And so I'll tell you the truth, between everybody talks about November being business planning month. Like for us, it's a really busy time of year. Like, I don't think people think that like that's when people are buying Root Beach real estate. But what I find is October, November, March, April, like those are our two really busiest times of the year. Let's say, to me, our most serious buyers are coming in at those times. They're ready to buy. So that week between Christmas and New Year's, we went to our coaching summit. We've wrote down a bunch of ideas that we like. Plus, we have the ones from last year. We'll evaluate everything, pick them out, pick out 20 of them, 1 through 20, and we'll start implementing. So I think you've got to be strategic in what you want to do, and you can't bring everything into your business, not all at once.
It sounds like you have 5 years of implementation ahead of you. You got 20 things, you're going to do 4 things a year.
Well, I mean, Dusty, seeing what you built and like, you can have mindset. People always talk about mindset, but what's the roadmap to go from a single agent or somebody like me to what you've done? You've got a whole big team. I mean, I feel like I'm slipping around, but I'm like honestly curious. Like I feel like I have the mindset portion, but how do you go from you to what you are today?
You know, I think what I was real focused on was the customer, and I didn't want anything slipping through the cracks. I wanted to make sure that we had excellent customer service all the time. And as I was growing as a single agent, you know, I was blowing and going 100 miles an hour. And then it got to the point where my next step was I was good at sales, but I wasn't good at the paperwork side of things. And I wasn't real focused on the paperwork side of things. So then I brought on my first assistant, and then it allowed me to do a little bit more. And then at that point, I just seized an opportunity where I saw a trend nationwide was where the teams were. And so teams weren't really a big thing in Birmingham. And so I kind of seized that opportunity and really had identified some talent. And it all came from a plethora of leads. So it started with, I had too many leads. I wanted to make sure that we gave like the best customer service experience possible. And there was just more business. So then I added one person, knocked it out of the park. And then we started adding more and more and more. So we just, it came from service and a plethora of leads. And then we grew small. We grew just one person at a time. And it really, we wanted to make sure that the process was, you know, that we were able to help each person. But now we're at the level and the scale that we're creating the training programs where as soon as we have somebody come in, then they go through a whole training program so that we can truly scale it up.
Are you documenting those systems processes? How's that?
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, we've got listing coordinator, we've got closing coordinator, they have their own systems and processes. And so we've got an onboarding checklist, we've got a training checklist. So we're very systemized and process. I know, you know, not everybody loves Nick Saban in Alabama, but I say we have a process and his big thing is the process. And I think that's what's helped, you know, just in having different agents on our team. We've been able to stay while losing some of our top agents to going, you know, being single agents. We've maintained selling over 400 homes a year for over 3 years. And it's all because of our systems, processes, and marketing and having just the right support staff. And we just have a proven system and a process.
So, for me, what I take away is, like, the first thing you have to do is you got to procure enough leads to where you get to where – you just can't handle anymore. And if you're constantly providing world-class customer service, and like I think like every agent wants to do that, that's our goal. We have the systems and processes in place to do that. Mm-hmm. Then you start stacking on top of that. But you got to document it. You got to create those. So if somebody leaves, you can plug somebody back in.
Yeah, and I think it's as easy as just putting everything down. Like, think about every piece of the transaction and just jotting it down, and then you create that system and a process. And so, and then guess what? You test it out. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, you try something else. And so we're constantly trying to get that better. I mean, we are constantly trying to make sure that nothing slips through the cracks. We're checking every box. Because, I mean, our clients are going through a stressful period of time. Buying or selling a house is not fun. It's not easy. And they're just in a different mindset and mentality. And so they're very, it's a delicate situation. So we want to make sure that they're really in good hands. They don't have to worry about things as they're getting through the mortgage process, getting, you know, final clear to close. So it's really important for us to give that white glove service.
Awesome. Awesome. Like, who taught you that?
I don't know. I mean, I grew up in the business world. I mean, my dad had restaurants, and it was very white tablecloth. It was all about the experience, and it was very service oriented. And then my mom had different businesses. And so, you know, luckily I did have entrepreneurial minded parents, and it was just kind of set in stone from early age. Like, here's what we provided. And this is the kind of the experience that we wanted to share with our clients.
I love that, because for me, like, my dad was a scientist. I didn't come from, like, you know, he was not an entrepreneur. And it's interesting now, he's retired and he's got his hands in entrepreneurship. And he's blocked a little bit harder than what he thinks or thought. So for me, I didn't have that background. So there's several different ways that you can get, you know, learn that. You can, there's a ton of YouTube videos and social media. There's more people out there providing information on how to do stuff. But, like, how do you vet it out? Is that good information? Is it bad information? If you're lucky, you find a mentor that just takes you under their wings and shows you how to do it.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the most important things that anybody, especially getting into the real estate business, they need a mentor. Like, if you don't have somebody that's willing to hold your hand through the process of growing your real estate business, it is a very difficult road by yourself. So if you don't have that guidance, I would encourage everybody that's watching that might not have that mentorship to find a mentor and find that person fast.
I could not agree more that, like, you know, the problem is when you're a new agent, you just don't know what you just don't know. And so you don't know to ask the questions, and you get these promises from people, and they don't mean to mislead you, but they don't realize how little time they actually have to spend on you. And I think that's why you see a failure rate that's very high in this industry, just because I remember being a broker owner. I so wanted to help everybody make sure they were successful. But there's so many things pulling at you in a brokerage role. Like, you got to recruit. You got to make sure that everybody has their paperwork in order and you're not going to get sued. And if you're undercapitalized like we were, and I tell you, it takes a lot more capital than what you really think to do a brokerage at a high level and make it profitable, then you also have to sell just so you can keep the lights on. And yeah, that's one of the things that I, like, kind of was one of our struggles was that, like, I'm competing against the same people I'm working with. So you can either, you have a mentor, or you can pay somebody to go be a coach. I think you do that. Benny was actually a coach. I pay somebody because I think, to me, you got to have a roadmap. That's where coaching comes from. You got to have some competition, like, at a high level. Like, we're not talking about the person that's getting their license right now. We're talking to somebody that's maybe in a $3 to $5 million range. You know, they're kind of ready to step up a little bit more. So some competition in your same range, I think it's good to have somebody push you. And then the accountability. Unfortunately, I just think human beings, we're wired for most of us, we're wired. I'm this way. I'm just lazy. Like, I mean, I hate to say it. Who hasn't had that big month and then let your foot off the gas? And then you feel it 2 months down the road. So, like, have somebody say that I've got to turn in a call sheet every week with who I talk to, like, or otherwise I'm going to pay a fine. I'm going to get ridiculed in front of my peers. Like, I don't want that pain. I think it's very important. And one of the things that I love about eXp is on some level, and I think better than most other brokers, is that they have very high level agents teaching the classes of how they got to where they are. And I've never seen like a culture where people are so willing to share that information. I remember when I got into real estate and I had all these friends that were, you know, high level agents, and I wanted to, like, you'd see them out or you'd be at a dinner together. They didn't want to talk shop with me. And I wanted to talk shop because I wanted to see what they were doing. And so I thought if I ever got to where I was halfway decent at this, that I would just show my whole game plan. And that's what I do. Like, anybody that wants to ever sit down with me, like, I give you all the forms, exactly how we plan our days, like what we do. And the problem is like implementation. Like, how quickly can you implement it? Most people won't implement it. And then, like, having that accountability to make sure you're doing it.
I agree 100%. All right. So I want to, we don't have a lot of time left, but I want to, understand, you had this brokerage and this franchise, and that was something that both Genny and I have been in that brokerage world running that. Why in the world did you shut that down to partner with eXp?
Opportunity. Like, I mean, I don't like beating around the bush. I mean, it was opportunity. It was financial well-being for not just me and my family, but, like, honestly, brokerages, owning a brokerage was a really good deal, I think, when it was 50-50 splits were the norm.
Right.
That's not the norm anymore.
No.
And this is the only way that I think a brokerage can be really profitable is to hold people at that 50-50 split. So, and it kind of was heart-wrenching for me on two levels. We had that outlay of cash every month for rent, employees, lead gen, all that. But what was even harder was, like, I had to hold our people, because we ran our brokerage. We went from 29 agents at our peak. We trimmed it back to 9, and I ran that brokerage like a team. But so I was holding people at a really accountable, and I think teams are great. They are, like, especially when you're starting out, like, to have somebody that has the systems in place that can teach you how to be a really good real estate agent, that is key. And that's where I think most people should start off in that sort of situation. But at a certain point, when you're holding people accountable at a high level, you're like, hey, guys, I need you to be calling these people. You can spend a couple hours a day. Well, like, if you're on a 50-50 split, you're never going to be able to reach your full potential. I'm trying to reach mine, right? Now, there are some people that I think that they are just built for a team. They that interaction, they need that. If you give them a lead, they can go close it, right? They don't want to go generate the lead. And so it was hard for me. Like, we just weren't financially aligned. My agents and me were not financially aligned. I was not financially aligned. And, you know, my partner at the time, still one of my very best friends. And and we were having lunch about a month ago, and we were talking about, you know, the brokerage and what I'm trying to do now and what he's trying to do now. He's like, dude, it just was not – he's a business guy. He's very successful. He's like, kid, you did a good job. There's just not any way to make money at this game.
Right. Unfortunately, that's just the truth. Yeah. That is just the truth.
And that's the reason why, you know, me and we were talking about the stock with eXp and, what's your exit strategy? Like, I could see myself doing this. I really love selling real estate. I see myself doing this for 24 years. Not a problem. And maybe even beyond that, maybe at a lower level, but continuing to do this. But, like, what was going to be, at the end of the day, you quit selling real estate. What do you do for income? Like, you can go invest in rental properties. That's a good strategy. You can put your money in the stock market. But, like, let's face it, we're real estate agents. We usually don't put enough money away to pay the IRS at the end of the year. So, like, that, you know, so the stock was a big deal for me. And, like, we're coming in on our 18th month. We have $50,000 or $55,000 in stock in 18 months.
That's good, Angelo. So good.
I think we've paid in 21 because we take advantage of buying the stock at the discount.
Right.
And that's equal to 55,000. And it hasn't even gone up. Actually, it's gone down a little bit from when I first started. But it went down and went back up. I hope it stays low for a little while longer, honestly. I was like, you know what? If you look 20 years down the road, like, what's that going to be worth? Then, if we continue just at our same level, which we're not, we're going to grow. I love bringing people into this company. I mean, they have the agent attraction side, which is a really nice side of the business. I don't know anybody that offers it like eXp offers it. I mean, eXp has a system. Keller Williams has a little bit of something. But at the end of the day, like, being able to pass that down to your wife and kids, like, I truly believe – like, it changes the trajectory of my life. Like, and not just my life, but my kid. You don't have
to. And everybody that you surround yourself with.
Yeah.
You know, everybody that you financially align yourself with, it makes a huge difference. And you're truly impacting, you know, your agents' lives. And I mean, that's, you know, when I made the decision, I knew it was going to positively affect everybody that I surrounded myself with. And that's why it was the best decision for me.
You know, and you say that. Like, you're right. It positively affects us. But, like, as you see them grow and you want to see that growth, they, like, it's financial alignment. Like, I always tell people, are you financially aligned with the people you're in business with? Because, like, that's where most things go sideways. I saw this interview with Tom with Charlie Munger. He's, Berkshire Hathaway, up there with him. And they own a bunch of companies, and they were talking about the problem Wells Fargo had, you know, about a year and a half ago. And he said, well, what do you think about that? He said, well, let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater. Like, I guarantee you this week we're going to get a call with one of the companies we're own. Something's going to have gone wrong, and it's going to be usually some sort of human issue. And the first question they ask themselves is, where are we out of alignment? Like, usually it's out of alignment financially. And so that's where you get people that do stuff that may be unethical, negatively impacting them, but negatively impacting your company. But if you're all rowing in the same direction and you're all aligned, the stuff that you can do is, it's crazy.
It's time. Yeah. Genny, I think it's time for, we got to wrap it up. It's, we've had a great hour with you, Angelo.
Man, I've enjoyed it. I could keep going, but like.
I know. We got a time limit, though. the next one we can do on a boat.
Let's just go fishing.
I like it. And Drew, thank you so much for your sweet comment. I have 9 mentees, and Drew was one of them. So he said, thankful for my mentor.
So. Hey. Anybody that has you as a mentor is a lucky person.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being here today. And how can people reach you? If you have referrals for Angelo, that want to live in Orange Beach, give him a call. How do you do that? What's your number?
All right. So 850-287-3440. Or just get on Facebook, go to the Coastal Connection, send me a private message. We'll reach out to you. We'll take very good care of you. I promise you it'll be one of the best transactions you ever have.
I believe it.
All right. Y'all have a great day.
Hey, we will see you on the 16th. Angelo is coming to Birmingham. And so if you have not already registered for our Seize All of Your 2020 Opportunities, definitely do that, because Angelo's got some awesome nuggets that he's going to be sharing that day as well. So thanks so much, and we'll see you then.
Thank you, guys. Y'all have a great day.
Bye. See you. Bye-bye.